Hello everyone, this is Pooja Jha and I am a legal intern at Lexis & Company for the month of July. Today I am going to discuss about the concept of corporate veil and piercing of corporate veil. A company is a separate legal entity and it is distinct from its members too. A company is not a living body, hence the members work on behalf of the company behind the veil. In simple terms, this veil can be called as corporate veil. There arise many circumstances where the corporate veil is removed, which is known as piercing of corporate veil. To check any further fraudulent activities conducted by the members of the companies, or if the company is working with the compliance with rules and regulations provided by the Companies Act. In this discussion, we will delve into the theory of corporate veil. So let's get started. A corporate veil is a legal concept which separates the actions of an organization to the actions of shareholders. Moreover, it protects the shareholder from being liable for the company's actions. In such case, a court can also determine whether they hold shareholders responsibility for the company's actions or not. So here comes the term of piercing of corporate veil, which refers to a circumstance where court set aside the limited liability of the shareholder and hold a company's investors or directors personally liable for the organization's fraudulent activities. Going further with the concept of piercing of the veil, the liability protection of a corporation is quite important. Unfortunately, it is not always absolute. Piercing the corporate veil takes off the distinction between the owner and the business, and the distinction and this distinction is stripped away. The owners or the shareholder working on behalf of the company become personally responsible for the financial condition of the business, like as they would be if the company was a sole proprietorship, or in case of partnership also, if two partners will be responsible for that. Okay. So piercing of the corporate veil generally occurs when someone like a creditor or a person who has been affected by the business takes any legal action against the company. He would argue that the owners of the business should be held personally liable for the money that is at stake. So court in such circumstances does not easily agree to pierce the corporate veil for any random situation, since the entire purpose of creating the veil is to protect the owners and allow the business to operate in its own independence. However, the court will pierce the corporate veil in situations where the owners, directors or shareholders commit frauds or fail to follow the corporate formalities or have acted inappropriately. Moving forward with the factors or judicial grounds on which the corporate veil can be lifted. Though there is no definite set of equation for the number of factors that can determine or that can be validated to pierce the corporate veil, there are particular factors that raise red marks. A few worth noting are: first one being the existence of fraud or wrongdoing to the third parties, or fraud or misconduct by the company. One of the biggest factors that the court condemns is the existence of fraud or any wrongdoing or any improper conduct by the company. The courts have been more than prepared to pierce the corporate veil when it feels that the fraud is being conducted by the company inside the veil. One of the classic example of this fraud exception is the case of Guilford Motor Company Limited versus Horn. In the case of Guilford Motor Company Limited versus Horn, Mr. Horn was an ex-employee of the Guilford Motor Company, and his employment contract provided that he could not solicit any customer of the company. In order to defeat this, he started a limited company in his wife's name and solicited the customers of the company. The company brought an action against him. So in this case, it was clear that the main purpose of incorporating a new limited company was to perpetrate fraud. The second factor to lift the corporate veil can be for the benefit of revenue. The court has the power to disregard corporate entity if it is used for tax evasion or circumvent tax obligation. For example, if a company forms another company just to avoid any super tax or to avoid any kind of tax obligation, that company will not be considered as a corporate entity. The court has power to disregard that company as a corporate entity. Thirdly, a corporate veil can be lifted if a company tries to avoid a welfare legislation. The approach of the court in considering problem arising out of such avoidance of welfare legislation is generally same to the avoidance of taxation. It is the duty of the court in every case where indemnity is expended to avoid a welfare legislation to get behind the smoke screen and discover the real truth. When a company acts as an agent, when a company is acting as an agent of a shareholder, they will be liable for the acts of the company, and the corporate veil can be lifted on this ground. For instance, in the case of FG Film Limited, an American company financed the production of a film in India in the name of a British company. The president of American company held 90% of capital in the British production company. The British government refused to register it as a British film. It was held that the decision was valid in the view of the fact that the British company acted merely as a nominee of the American company. Another red flag that could lead to piercing of corporate veil is the failure to follow the corporate formalities. In cases where the formalities are not legally followed, the courts have held that the liability of protection of the shareholder will be waived off, and the personal assets of the owner can be tied in this case. Further, inadequately capitalization of the company. The court will check the asset of the company to determine if the company's quantum of assets available for the creditors is appropriate or not, whether it is a scene of undercapitalization. In such case, the court can order to lift the corporate veil. So, there are certain statutory provisions for lifting of corporate veil as well. Firstly, Section 2, Clause 60 of the Companies Act, which provides for the officer in default. And this section deals with the liability of an officer in default, that is, those individuals who are involved in any illegal or wrongful activities and are thus liable for the offences individually. Secondly, the fraudulent conduct. Section 339 of the Companies Act deals with the fraudulent conduct. Whenever in case of winding up of the company, it is found that the company's name was being used for any fraudulent activity. Thirdly, Section 39 of the Companies Act deals with the failure to refund application money. Under this section, if the directors of the company are jointly and severally liable to repay the application money with the interest, if the company fails to refund it within 130 days of the date of issue of prospectus. So, as a result of incorporation, an incorporated company wears a corporate veil and thus acquires a corporate personality behind which there are shareholders, members who have formed the company. The corporate personality can be unveiled in certain situations where it is used for illegal or fraudulent activities, and shareholders and directors behind it may be held liable for such activities.